Hare Krishna, welcome to this episode of Bhagavad Gita. Today we'll be studying chapter 6, verses 9 and 10 of the Bhagavad Gita. Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Namo Bhagavate Vasudevaya, Om Ajnanatimirandhasya Jnananjana Shalakaya Chakshurunmilitam Yena Tasmai Shri Gurave Namaha. Shri Chaitanya Mano Bhishtam Sthapitam Yena Bhutale Swayam Rupah Kadamahyam Dadati Swapadantikam Vandeham Shri Guru Shri Utapadakamalam Shri Gurun Vaishnavamscha Shri Rupam Sagrajatam Sahagana Raghunathanvitam Tamsajivam Sadvaitam Savadhutam Parishana Sahitam Krishna Chaitanya Devam Shri Radha Krishna Padan Sahagana Lalita Shri Vishakhanvitamscha. He Krishna Karuna Sindho Dinabandho Jagatpate Gopesha Gopika Kanta Radha Kanta Namostute Tapta Kanchana Gaurangi Radhe Vrindavaneshwari Vrishabhanu Sute Devi Pranamami Hari Priye Vanchakalpatarubhyascha Kripa Sindhubhya Evacha Patitanam Bhavanebhyo Vaishnavebhyo Namo Namaha Namo Vishnu Padaya Krishna Preshthaya Bhutale Srimate Bhakti Vedanta Swaminiti Namine Namaste Saraswati Deve Gauravani Pracharine Nirvishesha Sunyavadi Paschatya Deshatarine Jaya Shri Krishna Chaitanya Prabhu Nityananda Shri Advaita Gadadhar Shri Vasadi Gaura Bhakta Vrinda Hare Krishna 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 Hare 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 Rama Hare Rama 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 Hare Hare. So welcome to this episode of Bhagavad Gita. It has been a long time since we have met for discussing Bhagavad Gita. And in today's session, we will be studying two verses, 9 and 10 of the 6th chapter of the Bhagavad Gita. Alright, so word to word and then line by line. So I think I won't be doing the repeating after me and all because it's already late. So Suhrit Mitra Ari Udasina Madhyastha Dvesha Bandhushu Sadhushu Api Cha Papeshu Samabuddhi Vishishyate. Suhrin Mitrari Udhasina Madhyastha Dvesha Bandhushu Sadhushvapicha Papeshu Samabuddhir Vishishyate. Suhrit, to well wishers by nature, Mitra, benefactors with affection, Ari, enemies, Udhasina, neutrals between belligerents, Madhyastha, mediators between belligerents, Dvesha, the envious, Bandhushu, and the relatives or well-wishers, Sadhushu, unto the pious, Api, as well as, Cha, and Papeshu, unto the sinners, Samabuddhi, having equal intelligence, Vishishyate, is far advanced. If we see the word belligerents, hostile, aggressive people. So, Udasina means neutrals between belligerents. Madhyastha, mediators between belligerents. Translation by His Divine Grace A.C. Bhaktivedanta Swami Srila Prabhupada Ki Jai. A person is considered still further advanced when he regards honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, the neutral, the mediators, the envious, the friends and enemies, the pious and the sinners, all with an equal mind. In the previous verse, if you see, it is said a person is said to be established in self-realization and is called a yogi or mystic when he is fully satisfied by virtue of acquired knowledge and realization. Such a person is situated in transcendence and is self-controlled. He sees everything, whether it be pebbles, stone or gold, as the same. So pebbles, stone or gold are basically non-living things. They are dull matter. Now here are living beings who we may classify as enemies, friends, and because we have a relationship with them, some sort of relationship, which is more stronger than with just inanimate things, you know. Let's look at the Sanskrit of the previous verse. Jnana vijnana triptatma kutastho vijitendriyah yukta ityuchyate yogi samaloshtrashma kanchanah. Suhrin mitraryudasinam madhyastha dvesha bandhushu sadhushvapi chapapeshu samabuddhir vishishyate. So he regards everybody as the same. Now here we have to understand clearly that when we say all these different, like honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, the neutrals, mediators, envious friends and enemies, the pious and the sinners, all with an equal mind. How is it possible? Now, let me show you this other verse from Srimad Bhagavatam. This is especially of the advanced devotee who becomes a preacher. He is situated between the first class and the second class devotees, and his range of activities actually includes these things. Ishvaretada dhineshu balisheshu dvishatsucha prema maitri kripopeksha yahkaroti samadhyamaha. An intermediate or second class devotee called Madhyama Adhikari offers his love to the Supreme Personality of Godhead, is a sincere friend to all the devotees of the Lord, shows mercy to ignorant people who are innocent, and disregards those who are envious of the Supreme Personality of Godhead. Now here it is said that one has to deal, especially when one is advanced in devotional life. Advanced means midway in his advancement. More advanced than the third class devotee, the neophyte, who is not very advanced and who cannot distinguish between devotees and non-devotees, or desirable things or non-desirable things. He's not very experienced yet. But those who are a little more advanced, especially these second class devotees, are called preachers. So they will preach. So we have to rise from the third class platform to at least the second class platform in order to be stable in our devotional life. And in the second class platform, one has to function in this way. One has to see that this is the Supreme Lord, these are the devotees, these are the innocent, these are the envious. Now of course there are subcategories between devotees. Devotees more advanced than oneself, devotees on an equal level, devotees less advanced than oneself. And then in non-devotees, again there is classification which is already mentioned, which is innocent and envious. With each of these different classes of people, he behaves differently. But in today's verse, it is said that one, you know, regards everyone as the same, whether honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, neutrals, mediators, envious friends, enemies, pious sinners, all with an equal mind. Now, how can we correlate and how can we, you know, kind of consolidate both these two seemingly opposing views? So the thing here is this. So with the materialistic class of people, and in fact I'll just add to this a little bit more in the Nectar of Instruction. If you go to second verse, yeah, atyahara prayasascha prajalpo niyamagraha janasangascha laulyamcha shadbhir bhakti vinashyati. One's devotional service is spoiled by the following six activities, and one of them is associating with worldly minded persons who are not interested in Krishna consciousness. So they, we have to target them, and once we have identified them, stay away from them. So this is not exactly behaving with an equal mind with all of them, right? There is a judgment that is to be made. Okay, this is non-devotee class of people, so I should not associate. So there's a judgment to be made. This is non-devotee. And then we have to take action on that judgment. So we have to, like, not associate with them. And then we have to identify those who are devotees and then seek their association. That's what explained in the next verse. Utsahan nischayat dhairyat tattat karma pravartanat sangatyagat sato vritte shadbhir bhakti vina prasiddhyati. There are six principles favorable to the execution of pure devotional service. Enthusiastic, endeavoring with confidence, being patient, acting according to the regulative principles, abandoning the association of non-devotees, following in the footsteps of previous acharyas. That means also staying in the company of devotees. And in fact, next verse even says how to cultivate our devotional relationships with devotees. Dadati pratigrihanati guhyam akhyati prichati bhungte bhojayate chaiva shadvidham priti lakshanam. So, offering gifts in charity, receiving, accepting charitable gifts, revealing one's mind in confidence, inquiring confidentially, accepting prasad and offering prasad are the six symptoms of love shared by one devotee and another. Now these are not only between devotees, even between non-devotees, everywhere these things go on. You know, of course it's not prasad, but it's food. In fact, here it is said bhungte bhojayate, eats and feeds. In the devotee's context, it will be offering prasad and accepting prasad. But in the non-devotees, this same thing will apply. These are all Preeti Lakshanam. These are all symptoms of affection. This can happen between anyone. But if we do these things, these, affectionate dealings with non-devotees, then we'll get implicated and we should not do that. Janasangha, we have to give up. Sangha Tyagat. And Sangha means these things. But these things have to be cultivated among the devotees. So again, there is a difference. So how to consolidate these things? There is a fifth verse also. Here. Krishneti yasya giritam manasadriyeta dikshasti chet pranati bhish cha bhajantamisham shushrushaya bhajana vignamananyamanya Nindadi shunya hridami psita sangalabdhya. One should mentally honor the devotee who chants the holy name of Lord Krishna. One should offer humble obeisances to the devotee who has undergone spiritual initiation, diksha, and is engaged in worshipping the deity. And one should associate with and faithfully serve that pure devotee who is advanced in undeviated devotional service and whose heart is completely devoid of the propensity to criticize others. So you see again, even among devotees, different kinds of associations. So how can we see everyone with an equal mind, as it is said here? So here it is especially mentioning those people who are materialistic. In the materialistic domain, one may be affectionate, honest well-wishers, affectionate benefactors, neutral people, mediators, the envious, friends and enemies, pious and sinners, all on the material plane. Now, all of them have to be treated with an equal mind. When it is said that we have to give up materialistic association, it's not that we hate them. It's that we keep away from them to avoid contamination. So preaching means we have to infect them. Instead of being infected by them, we have to infect them with Krishna consciousness. So that means one has to be sufficiently surcharged with Krishna consciousness, and one has to be brimming with Krishna consciousness, and then he can pass it on to others. So, of course, even if we are not as brimming, if we distribute Prabhupada's books, then Prabhupada, who is brimming with unending devotional service to Krishna, so he will inspire them through the teachings. Now, on the material plane, whatever may be the class of people, they are all called Asat Sangha. Asat Sangha Tyaga, A Vaishnavachara. But the same devotee will greatly treasure the association of devotees. Let me take you to this verse, Srimad Bhagavatam, even Bhagavad Gita, 10th chapter, 9th verse. See this. Machitta madgata prana bodhayanta parasparam kathayantas chamam nityam tushyanti cha ramanti cha. The thoughts of my pure devotees dwell in me, their lives are fully devoted to my service, and they derive great satisfaction and bliss from always enlightening one another and conversing about me. So they are always happy, devotees are happy by conversing with other devotees. And let me take you to some beautiful verses. There are so many verses highlighting the importance of the association of devotees. We just can't get enough of them. So many. Okay, this is from 11:230. Ata atyantikam kshemam prichhamo bhavato naghah samsaresmin kshanardhopi satsanga shevadhir nirnam. Therefore, O completely sinless ones, I ask you to kindly tell me what the supreme goal is. After all, even half a moment's association with pure devotees within this world of birth and death is a priceless treasure for any man. So the devotee association is a priceless treasure. Non-devotee association, not the same. So how to see everybody as the same? Another one. Chaitanya Charitamrita. Of course, there is that famous verse. Sadhu sanga sarva shastra koi, lava matra sadhu sanga sarva siddhi hoy. Aho mahatman bahudosha dushto, apyekena bhatyesha bhavo gunena, satsangamakhyena sukhavahena. Kritadhyano yena krishamu muksha. O great learned devotee, although there are many faults in this material world, there is one good opportunity, the association with devotees. Such association brings about great happiness. Due to this good quality, our strong desire to achieve liberation by merging into the Brahman effulgence has become weakened. This is from Haribhakti Sudhodaya. Again, the importance of the association of devotees is again stressed. So many verses like this, 3:25, 10:14, 3, so many are there that highlight the importance of devotee association. In fact, let me take you to this other verse, Chaitanya Charitamrita, 22:83. Krishna bhakti janma mula hoy sadhu sanga, Krishna prema janmete ho punah mukhya anga. The root cause of devotional service to Lord Krishna is association with advanced devotees. Even when one's dormant love for Krishna awakens, association with devotees is still most essential. And I think in the same chapter, we have this one. Mahat kripa vina kon karme bhakti nai. Krishna bhakti dure raho samsara nahe kshay. Unless one is favored by a pure devotee, one cannot attain the platform of devotional service. To say nothing of Krishna bhakti, one cannot even be relieved from the bondage of material existence. So all this is pointing to one direction, that there has to be is that the word dichotomy? I think it is. Let's see what dichotomy is. A division or contrast between two things that are or are represented as being opposed or entirely different. Yeah, exactly the word. So this dichotomy has to be defined, and a devotee should very well be aware of which association to take and which association not to. So this dichotomy is very essential, right? So how can we see with equal mind? So this equal mind, when it is said, it is referring to the non-devotee association. That's why we will see in the next verse. Let's read the next verse, because there it is mentioned that one should stay alone. That is only good if the population is non-devotees. But if it is devotees, then one should not stay alone. And we will take you to another verse which explains this in more detail. Now, 6.10. Yogi yunjita satatam atmanam rahasi sthitah ekaki yata chittatman nirashira parigrahah. Yogi, a transcendentalist, yunjita, must concentrate in Krishna consciousness, satatam, constantly, atmanam, himself, by body, mind and self, rahasi, in a secluded place, sthitaha, being situated, ekaki, alone, yata chittatma, always careful in mind, nirashi, without being attracted by anything else, aparigraha, free from the feeling of possessiveness. Now, Bhaktivinoda Thakur has sung, ekaki amar nahi paya bala harinama sankirtane. So, he said, alone I have no strength to perform the sankirtan movement or to chant the holy name. In other, of course, he can. He in fact did it in the last 4 years of his life. He was completely shut off. Nirjan bhajan, this is called technically. That means without any contact with the outside world, they're just always chanting and doing their own devotional service. So he lived like that for 4 years of his life, from 1910 to 1914, when he attained samadhi, left his body. He was like that. But that is only possible for such an advanced devotee who was on the first class platform, Uttama Adhikari, Mahabhagavat. But for the rest of us, we can't do this ekaki. We will be, you know, in fact, Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur completely condemned that, because in Kali Yuga we will be distracted by so many thoughts, and especially of women and money, and one will not be able to maintain his seclusion and purity in his seclusion. Therefore, in Kali Yuga especially, it is better to stay in the association of devotees. Sango Pangastra Parshadam. One has to stay in the Sangha. Chaitanya Mahaprabhu actually inaugurated such a movement where he is with his devotee, he is with his association. And also it is Sankirtan. Sankirtan means congregational chanting. It is much more powerful than alone chanting. So that congregational chanting, not only chanting means the holy names, that is also, of course, one of the main aspects. But also listening to Harikatha, Krishna Katha, topics about Krishna. So that is also as important, and that we have to do in the association of devotees, and we have to be trained under the association of devotees. These are all very essential items in devotional advancement. So when it is said Rahasi, means secluded place. See, live alone in a secluded place and should always carefully control his mind. Now let's read the purport, and we will explain the whole thing, or we'll try to explain. Purport. Krishna is realized in different degrees as Brahman, Paramatma, and the Supreme Personality of Godhead, or Bhagavan. Krishna consciousness means concisely to be always engaged in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. That is Krishna consciousness. To be always engaged in the transcendental loving service of the Lord. But those who are attached to the impersonal Brahman, or the localized super soul, are also partially Krishna conscious, because impersonal Brahman is the spiritual ray of Krishna and super soul is the all-pervading partial expansion of Krishna. Thus, the impersonalist and the meditator are also indirectly Krishna conscious. Well, that's a very big euphemism there. Many places they are actually condemned. A directly Krishna conscious person is the topmost transcendentalist, because such a devotee knows what is meant by Brahman and Paramatma. His knowledge of the absolute truth is perfect, whereas the impersonalist and the meditative yogi are imperfectly Krishna conscious. What is imperfectly Krishna conscious? Imperfectly Krishna conscious means, of course, there are three stages of realization of the absolute truth. So the impersonal and the localized Paramatma features, they are partial representation of the absolute truth. The complete representation is of Bhagavan. And once one understands Bhagavan feature, then one automatically understands the Paramatma and the Brahman features. Just as much as if one knows the sun god, he will automatically know the sun planet and the sun rays. But if one knows the sun's rays, he may not know the sun planet and the sun god. He won't know. Even if one knows sun rays and sun planet, he may still not know the sun god. So he cannot understand the situation in its entirety. That is only possible by a devotee who has understood the Bhagavan feature. And he is called a Vaishnava. Brahmajanaditi Brahmana. And one who is serving Vishnu is a Vaishnava. So, Vishnu means a personal form. So, they are imperfectly Krishna conscious, in other words. Nevertheless, all of these are instructed herewith to be constantly engaged in their particular pursuits so that they may come to the highest perfection sooner or later. The first business of a transcendentalist is to keep the mind always on Krishna. One should always think of Krishna and not forget him even for a moment. This is called samadhi. Concentration of the mind on the Supreme is called samadhi or trance. In order to concentrate the mind, one should always remain in seclusion and avoid disturbance by external objects. Especially with non-devotee association, we have to really follow this rigidly. But we have to associate with devotees. He should be very careful to accept favorable and reject unfavorable conditions that affect his realization. And in perfect determination, he should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. So these are actually summarizing how a devotee should live his life. You know? Now before we go further, I just want to take you to this verse. Srimad Bhagavatam, Canto 9. Chapter 6, text 51. Sangam tyajeta mithuna vratinam mumukshuh sarvatmanana visrjet bahirindriyani ekascharan rahasi chittam anantaiṣe yunjita tadvratishu sadhushu chet prasangah. Eka charan rahasi chittam ananta ishe yunjita tadvratishu sadhushu chet prasanga. A person desiring liberation from material bondage must give up the association of persons interested in sex life and should not employ his senses externally in seeing, hearing, talking, walking, and so on. One should always stay in a secluded place, completely fixing his mind at the lotus feet of the unlimited personality of Godhead, and if one wants any association at all, he should associate with persons similarly engaged. Now, again, and as in fact in Kali Yuga, this is more practical than staying alone. Staying alone I think we'll go bonkers. In Kali Yuga, we're not even practiced to live like that. So, and it is not necessary. We can actually stay comfortably in the association of devotees and learn how to become a devotee and be guarded by other devotees. They are the firewall against this virus of Maya. So that we have to surround ourselves with devotee association. Now when we say surround ourselves with devotee association, means not that I have to employ some devotees as my bodyguards. You know, 10 bodyguards, I'm walking everywhere. Not like that. We're talking about taking guidance from devotees at all times, at all places, in all circumstances. So such guidance will fence our devotional service, our devotional growth. So we have to have that fence, otherwise the creeper, you know, we will unnecessarily jeopardize the growth of the creeper. So you see how it is all related. They see everybody equal, especially, and they treat everybody equal by avoiding their association and associating only with devotees. So that's one aspect. The other aspect is when they distribute that mercy, when one is sufficiently advanced and at least on the second class platform, when he becomes a preacher, then he again bestows his mercy on the innocent non-devotee class of people equally. There's a very beautiful example in Prabhupada's life where he was asked by one Indian friend. He was kind of a little bit scholarly because he knew some verses of Bhagavad Gita and all. But then he friendly, in a joking way, in a friendly talk, he challenged Prabhupada. But Prabhupada, you say, I mean, you are on the first class platform. That's what I understand from your disciples. But then you are preaching. But you said preacher is second class. That means you are actually not first class, you are second class. Is it not? Are you first class or are you second class? I think you are second class, is it not? Prabhupada remains silent for a while. And he said, my equality is that I don't see whether it's a black or a white or a man or a woman or developed country or undeveloped country, whatever it is. I want to preach Hare Krishna, the mantra, to everyone. This is my equality. You see? So this equality means he preaching, in the preaching he does not make any compromise. He does not give it only to some richer class of people, but poorer class, I don't need to give. Not like that. No, everyone. What is that? Jati dhana vidya bala na kore apeksha. One second. What is this? Jati dhana vidya bala na kore apeksha. This is Nityananda Prabhu also like that. There is no consideration of jati, one's birth, dhana or wealth, vidya means intelligence and education, bala, strength. So there is no consideration of these aspects at all, just freely. So that is equality. So again, in the early stages one has to avoid such association, and in the second, that is the third class, and he has to associate with devotees. It is not that in second class we give up that principle. No, we still associate only with the devotees and avoid the association of non-devotees. But such a second class devotee preaches to the non-devotees, and that is not technically associating with them and taking their association. No, it is infecting them with his association. That is totally different. Whether I am taking association or whether I am giving association. So when it is said that we should not associate with the non-devotees, it is, the meaning is that we should not take their association, but we should give our association. And for that we have to be, you know, Prabhupada said purity is the force. So if we follow the principles, if we keep ourselves always connected with the Krishna consciousness by hearing, chanting and engaging all different kinds of services, then we can, you know, pass that, and you know, that experience and the, you know, that kind of infection of Krishna consciousness to others. And also by distributing Srila Prabhupada's books, which is actually the fundamental aspect of our entire movement. So these things have to be distributed to everyone, irrespective of caste, creed, color, race, nationality, gender, anything. So in that way, one has to conduct oneself. So he should avoid association, definitely, but he should give association. So this is something which impersonalists cannot understand and non-devotees misunderstand. So impersonalists, they just try to avoid all association and, you know, try to be happy in their so-called Brahman happiness. But devotees seemingly are amidst all kinds of materialistic people, and they can be easily misunderstood to be associates of materialists. And impersonalists may think like that, or even the non-devotees sometimes think, hey, why devotees have to be on social media? I thought you have given up all this materialism and all that, and then why are you on social media? You know, Instagram and TikTok and, you know, like now Clubhouse, you know, like YouTube. Why are you on all of this? I mean, you have to give up, right? You're a monk. So, yeah, we have to give up taking the association of these social media. But we have to give association there. Any channel that can be used for spreading the message of Krishna consciousness should be used. Other than that purpose, they should not be used. So for that reason, devotees may give association. That is alright, perfectly alright. But one cannot take association from them, from the non-devotees. And that also means that we can't make compromises with the non-devotees. Like, for example, there was a very illustrative conversation of Srila Prabhupada with some of his disciples. And Prabhupada was mentioning this point of convincing the materialistic people to accept our philosophy. Not that we have to talk in ways and means that would appeal to them in their own philosophical way. No. We have to bring them to our philosophy, we have to accept, make them accept our philosophy. But if we talk like them, if we try to appeal to them by talking like them, then we are accepting their association. So that's why we have to show them that what we have is far superior than what they have, and we'll continue to use our lingo, our kind of way of presentation, and not change the preaching methods, trying to suit to the modern population and talk some rubbish stories. These kind of things are beyond, you know, what is that, charted waters of the devotee. It means beyond permissible boundaries of the devotees. So we can't do any of that. And that actually means compromise. And that actually means taking association. That means I'm not unequivocally presenting the truth in straight Krishna consciousness language, but I'm actually kind of using their language and talking like them just to be so-called mixing with them and trying to give them Krishna consciousness. We just have to preach purely. When we preach purely, then the effect will be there. And if some people are not happy about it, let them be. Nothing to worry, you know, we don't have to really take it to heart. Our thing is that our mission should be, we have to preach without compromise. Then it is called giving association. But if I, for example, I'll give you a tangible example. Like nowadays, I have seen at least two or three sannyasis and some other brahmacharis also from our Hare Krishna movement advocating or supporting veganism. And many other devotees also, like, you know, I have seen kind of being vegan. So this is the whole vegan idea is a very, very, very faulty idea with full of mistakes. Although the intention was good, but because it is not connected with Krishna, the end result, if you carefully look at it from the viewpoint of Shastra, it is full of defects. Full of defects. So therefore, we have to accept only that philosophy that is enunciated by Krishna. Now, Krishna said, Yajnarthat, Yajna Shishtasana Santo Muchyante Sarvakil Vishaye. So we have to take only prasadam, then all our sinful activities will be nullified. But it is not the same as not eating only plant-based diet. Because even plants have life. We are not allowed to take any life. We can only take for the use of offering to Krishna and then eating the prasadam. Because Krishna asked in that category, we will provide him that category and eat prasadam. Otherwise, we have even no right to eat the plants that we are eating. So that is one point. And veganism does not take into account of all these things. I mean, there are so many points which I don't want to go into the rabbit hole because I have covered that many times. And I will do another video again with full explanation. We have done actually. I think we have done veganism in the, I think, Shastra Chakshu episode way back, a few years back. Anyway, this is the thing. The definition, if I accept something like vegan, for example, veganism is a materialistic idea without Krishna consciousness involved, so-called ahimsa, but then not according to Krishna's recommendation. Like milk is very essential for human beings, it's recommended by Krishna. And also onion and garlic, for example, they are plant-based, but we cannot eat. So it is not exactly vegetarian, it's not exactly vegan that we are following. We are, like Prabhupada said, prasadarians. Like vegetarians, non-vegetarians, prasadarians. So we advocate that. So it is different from just veganism or vegetarianism or anything like that. The fault of veganism, I think Dhira Prabhu has mentioned. Oh, we have done a Tattva Darshan show. So you see, so this veganism is a big problem. Like this, there are many other problems, materialistic movements. Like Prabhupada mentioned also that he was a sympathizer of the Gandhian movement at the time for national independence of India. But then later on, after he met his spiritual master Bhaktisiddhanta Saraswati Thakur, he understood that independence is not the main thing that is required. It is Krishna consciousness. It doesn't have to wait for independence or anything like that. So even by participating in such materialistic movements, however nice they may sound, oh, this is a huge cause, you know, Indian national freedom, you know, we have to support this. Now, millions of people will back that claim and everybody say yes, yes, yes. And if we say no, we will be looking like an absolute idiot among them. But we have to be, even at that point, we have to be completely convinced and sober that what we are doing is right and what they are doing is wrong. Usually we get carried away by public opinion, majority opinion. This is how democracy worked or works. And usually we fall into the trap, but actually we have to always be watchful whether I am falling into the trap of these materialists or not. So uncompromising preaching means not taking a single milligram of their association, just giving association, straightforward truth, present it. So that is giving association, and that is what it means by this he should remain equal with everyone and he should stay alone. That means he should not take anybody's association. But giving association, taking association, one should, only devotees association. One cannot stay without association, that is not possible. one has to associate with his mind. If he's with nobody, then he's with his mind. And a mind is the worst enemy to be with in an alone place. Would you go to a lonely place where nobody's around with your enemy? Will you go? And especially if he's extremely strong. Will you go to a place like that? No sane man will do it. But we think we can. We go with our mind. You can go to the remotest part in the universe. But you're sitting with your worst enemy all the time. This is the mind. And therefore, especially in Kali Yuga, one is completely ill-equipped to do this seclusion yoga. Or yoga in seclusion. So, we cannot do that. What we can do is, we associate with devotees and preach Krishna consciousness. Actually, that also means seclusion. Because we are not taking their association. But we are giving their association. So that is actually the complete meaning of seclusion. This is Yukta Vairagya. We associate with them, at the same time we don't associate with them. It means we give our association but not take their association. So in that way, we are always in seclusion. Because we shield ourselves from this non-devotee influence. But then we keep ourselves strong by associating with devotees. So let's continue with the purport. And in perfect determination, see, he should be very careful to accept favorable and reject unfavorable conditions that affect his realization. This is important. That's why Rupa Goswami has highlighted all the favorable incidents and unfavorable incidents. Or, what is that called? Conditions. And in perfect determination, he should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. The more things we have, the more possessive we become. Let's show you one verse about this possessive nature. 7:6-11-13. Katham priyaya anukampitaya sangam rahasyam ruchiram chamantran सुहृत् सुतत् स्नेह सिता शिशूनां कलाक्षराणां अनुरक्त चित्तः पुत्रान् स्मरंस्ता दुहृत्रीर् हृदया भ्रातृन् स्वश्रीर्वा पितरौ च दीनौ गृहान् मनोज्ञोरुपरिच्छदांश्च वृत्तिश्च कुल्याः पशुभृत्यवर्गान् त्यजेत कोशस्कृदिवेहमानः कर्माणि लोभाद् अवितृप्तकामः औपस्थ्यजैह्वं बहुमन्यमानः कथं विरज्येत दुरन्तमोहः. This aupasthya jaihvam. Now that gives rise to a whole paraphernalia of attachment and possessiveness. Now let's see. When we get into this possessive mentality, and this is how it works. How can a person who is most affectionate to his family, the core of his heart being always filled with their pictures, give up their association? How can he? Possessive. Specifically, a wife is always very kind and sympathetic and always pleases her husband in a solitary place. Who could give up the association of such a dear and affectionate wife? Small children talk in broken language, very pleasing to hear, and their affectionate father always thinks of their sweet words. How could he give up their association? One's elderly parents and one's sons and daughters are also very dear. A daughter is especially dear to her father, and while living at her husband's house, she is always in his mind. Who could give up that association? Aside from this, in household affairs, there are many decorated items of household furniture, and there are also animals and servants. Who could give up such comforts? The attached householder is like a silkworm which weaves a cocoon in which it becomes imprisoned, unable to get out. Simply for the satisfaction of two important senses, the genitals and the tongue. Aupasthya jaihvam. Jihva means tongue. Jaihvam means related to the tongue. Aupasthya means related to upastha or the genitals. So, aupasthya jaihvam. Bahumanyamana. He gives great importance to these things. Let's see. You see, consider bahumanyamana. Considering as very, very important. One is bound by material conditions. How can one escape? You think it is so easy that we can just give up everything and go to Krishna? Is that so easy? No. We cannot give up our family. We cannot give up our house, our everything, our comfort. No. So it's not so easy. This is feelings of possessiveness. One should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. Possessing all these things, like having a friendly family and, you know, all this household furniture, all these self-indulgence or indulgence of material senses and mind, may seem very comfortable and may seem very pleasing in the moment, but it is always the most painful at the time of death. Because we have to understand one thing. There are two situations in this material world. One is of not so intense danger and when everything is seemingly well. And the other is the when the danger is actually literally felt. Actually, both these conditions are dangerous. But in one, the danger is stark naked. It is right in front of our eyes. We know it's danger. And we can identify it. The other danger is far more dangerous than the visible danger because it's hidden. It's in stealth mode. The danger is in stealth mode. Why? Because when the life is going good and we are, you know, happy with our home, with our hearth, with our furniture, with our animals, with everything, we think it's, oh, I have a wonderful life. That's when the grip on us, Maya's grip on us, is just solidifying. You know how a snake eats, especially those constricting snakes, you know those snakes, some snakes, you know, just bite and then the poison is injected and then the person dies. That's one type of snakes. The other type of snakes are not as poisonous, but they are very, very strong. And they, like anaconda, constrictor boa. So these kind of snakes, they wrap around the person or the animal. And then, you know what, how they constrict? You see, there are already bones and everything. It's a hard frame, you know. Then how they constrict and break the bones also. You know, when we breathe, when we inhale, it becomes a little bit inflated, our body. So the snake lets us inhale. When we exhale, the body shrinks a little bit. And when it shrinks, the constrictor, the snake, will constrict as much as it can go. And then after that, we cannot expand more than that. And then we try to breathe there, in that level only. And when you do that again constrict more. Again constrict more and more. And break our whole thing and then eat us. Or eat any animal. So, and also when they eat a little bit and a little bit and a little bit. So why I'm telling all this example? Because when it is not so seeming danger, when everything is rosy, that's when actually the Maya is, you know, constricting us without us even knowing. Why? Because these very so-called happy moments are the ones which will give us pain at the time of death when we have to separate from them. These moments will flash in our mind, and then being attached to these moments is what causes us the pain at the time of death. And that, you know, because that is the danger, because it is just building up to the ultimate danger. Because at the time of death, we need to remember Krishna. But then we have passed the exam of death. If we do not remember the Krishna, then we have failed. So, in order for, what do we remember at the time of death? Whatever we are most attached to, that is the secret formula that Maya uses. Oh, whatever he is attached to. Sadatad bhava bhavita. Yamyam vapismaran bhavam tyajatyante kalevaram tam tam evaiti kaunteya sadatad bhava bhavitaha. See this. Whatever state of being one remembers when he quits his body, O son of Kunti, that state he will attain without fail. Now, there is actually something missing in this translation. And that is this part. Sadatad bhava bhavitaha. In fact, Prabhupada explains this in his lectures. Sada means always. Tat bhava, that state of being, remembering. We can remember at the time of death whatever we have been always remembering throughout our lives. So what do people remember? They remember their family, they are always remembering their, you know, the children, wife, and for the wife is the husband, and other near and dear. As you know, we have that those three verses we have just seen in the seventh canto. So these are the things that people remember. People have their phone wallpapers, you know, as their wife picture or their children's picture or their dog's picture, even worse. So these are the things that are filling up, you know, our consciousness. So what are we doing? So Maya is just laying the trap. And the stark naked dangers are when the trap is actually, you know, when the... Like, I think, let me take you to this. The only separation or the only difference between that visible danger and the invisible danger is our knowledge or ignorance of it. Otherwise, it's actually padam padam yad vipadam na tesham. Every step is full of danger. What was the verse I was thinking about? Oh, I lost the train of thought there. Wait. Well. I was going to show a verse. Oh yeah. Got it. Now let's look at this. 4:29:53, I think. Let me guess. Okay, these two are so interesting. These two verses, 4:29:53 and 4:29:54. 4:29:54 is basically, it's not a verse, it's a prose, it's like a mini essay, in fact. But we will read the Sanskrit because there are so many important words. Kshudram charam sumanasam sharane mithitva raktam shadangri ganasam asulubdha karnam agre vrikana sutripo viganayayantam पृष्ठे मृगम मृगय लुब्धक बाण भिन्नम. दिस ब्यूटिफुल डिपिक्शन ऑफ द स्टेट ऑफ अफेयर्स दैट आर गोइंग ऑन इन द मटेरियल वर्ल्ड. नाउ व्हेन वी आर यू नो हैविंग अ फन टाइम, दिस इज एक्चुअली व्हाट इज गोइंग ऑन विच वी कांट सी. Now, my dear king, please search out that deer who is engaged in eating grass in a very nice flower garden along with his wife. Having a fun time with his wife, you know, pleasant garden, flower garden. That deer is very much attached to his business and is enjoying the sweet singing of the bumblebees in his garden. Just try to understand his position. He is unaware that before him is a tiger, which is accustomed to living at the cost of another's flesh. Behind the deer is a hunter who is threatening to pierce him with sharp arrows. Thus, the deer's death is imminent. Now, you know, I just learned this a few weeks ago. I was watching this video of this deer and the tiger. How the tiger was talking the deer, and it is very interesting that the deer is standing in practically broad daylight in under no cover, and the tiger is just nearby, just right in front and nearby in the shades of the trees. And so he was moving. I was thinking, because this guy, this cameraman, he was filming the whole scene, and he was showing the deer, he was showing the tiger, and the deer is looking somewhere close to where the tiger was and somewhere a little bit off to an angle. But I mean, a human could have easily spotted that tiger. I was thinking, how come this deer can't even see the tiger? I mean, so foolish, so blind or what? But then the narrator actually explains. He says that the deer, like, we see three colors and the combinations of them, like, I think, what, L, what, green, RGB, yeah, red, green, blue, or yellow, blue, red, whatever. So these are the three colors, and then every other color is just basically a mixture of these three. But for the deer, they don't see three colors. They see only two colors, it seems. So they can't distinguish the movement, the orange of the tiger and the, you know, the. In fact, they can't see orange. They are blind to orange. For them, the trees, the tiger, it all just mixes up. In fact, the cameraman, I mean, the editing, they did the work very nicely. They actually changed the whole scene into a way where how the deer looks at it, and it's very, very fascinating, because you can't see the tiger. It was just so fascinating that when it was all these three colors, colorful, it was like, what, such a blind deer. And when he removes one of those colors, I think yellow or something he's removed, and then you the same thing, but the tiger is invisible now, completely invisible. So that was fascinating to see, and I actually remembered this verse at the time. I said, wow, this is, now I understand why the deer can't see the tiger. Here you see, actually it is mentioned, he is unaware that before him is the tiger. That means in front of him is the tiger. He can't see. This is the reason. That was interesting to note. So anyway, tiger is here, hunter is behind. He's basically minced meat in a matter of minutes. But because it has not come yet, because he's just about to be attacked, at the moment when he's not attacked, he thinks he's having a fun time. This is exactly how our position is. And the next verse, or rather prose, gives that context in our human life. Okay, now let's look at that. Sumanaha. This is not a verse, so I can't chant it in a tune. See, Sumanasam. What is that? Of a beautiful flower garden. Sumanasah sama dharmanam strinam sharana ashrame pushpa madhu gandhavat kshudratamam kamya karma vipakajam kama sukhalavam. Beautiful. Means the pleasure which we get from kama or lust is insignificant. Kama sukhalavam. Jaihvyaupasthyadi means, again, jaihva means tongue, related to the tongue, and aupasthya means related to the upastha, genitals. So that means eating and sex indulgence. Vichinvantam mithuni bhuya tad abhiniveshita manasam shadangri gana sama geetavad. Shadangri means, angri means legs. Shad means six. Shad Goswami, for example. Shat means six. Shat Sandarbha. So, Shadangri means six-legged creature. What is that? Insect or honeybee. Insects have six legs. So, Shadangri Gana Sama Geetavad. So, the song, Geeta means song. Vat means like. So, like the song of the honeybee. Humming of the honeybees. Ati Manohara Vanitadi Janalapeshvatitaram Ati pralobhita karnam agre virka yuthavad atmana ayur harato ho ratran tan kala lava visheshan aviganaya griheshu viharantam prishthata eva paroksham anupravritto lubdhakaha kritantontaha sharenayam iha paravidhyati tam imam atmanam mahorajan bhinna hridayam drashtum arhasiti. Now, much of that we don't know the meanings, so some of them we can actually catch. But anyway, I'm not going to go into all the word to word. We will see the entire translation. See, my dear king. Now, this is in comparison to that deer, which is having this fun time, but is just waiting to die. Very terrible death, the two, either by the tiger or by the hunter. It's basically mincemeat in minutes. Now, my dear king, woman, who is very attractive in the beginning, but in the end very disturbing, is exactly like the flower. This applies to the woman for the man also. I mean, the man may be attractive in the beginning and everything, but in the end, you know, it is basically because of lust. Because like the flower appears all blooming and nice and, you know, fragrant and this and that, beautiful. You just keep it for one day and then you will see at the end of the day how the flower will be. It just withered and then looks horrible. I mean, it smells horrible in a day or two and you just want to throw it away. So, woman is like that. It means the sexual attraction for the opposite sex is like that. My dear king, woman who is very attractive in the beginning, but in the end very disturbing, is exactly like the flower, which is attractive in the beginning and detestable at the end. With woman, the living entity is entangled with lusty desires and he enjoys sex, just as one enjoys the aroma of a flower. He thus enjoys a life of sense gratification from his tongue to his genitals, one straight line, from the tongue to the genitals. In between there is the belly. There is another satisfactory point. If one eats nicely and fills up the belly, he is very happy. And taste all nice kind of things, fill up the belly, increase the pressure on the genitals, and enjoy sex life with that. So, he enjoys a life of sense gratification from the tongue to his genitals. And in this way, the living entity considers himself very happy in family life. United with his wife, he always remains absorbed in such thoughts. He feels great pleasure in hearing the talks of his wife and children, which are like the sweet humming of bumblebees that collect honey from flower to flower. You remember this deer? Shadangri, again. Gana samasu lubdha karanam. The deer is very much attached to the business and he's enjoying the sweet singing of the bumblebees of his garden. Now, these are not just, you know, a deer's explanation of a deer, but these are actually related to our human life. And what are they? What are that humming of the bumblebees in human context? he feels great pleasure in hearing the talks of his wife and children, which are like the sweet humming of bumblebees that collect honey from flower to flower. He forgets that before him is time, which is the tiger, which is taking away his lifespan, just like the tiger is just taking away the lifespan of the deer by looking at the deer itself, with the passing of day and night. He does not see the gradual diminishing of his life, nor does he care about the superintendent of death who is trying to kill him from behind. Just try to understand this. You are in a precarious position and are threatened from all sides. So this is our position in the material world. We are always threatened, and that is why it is called padam padam yad vipadam na tesham. Every step is a danger. You may say, oh, that is an exaggeration. Come on. I mean, every day is not danger. You know, we're walking and you know. You know, just what happened 2 days ago or something, news in America. Everybody was sleeping in this apartment building. Sleeping. What happened? Entire building just collapsed into rubble for no reason. For no reason. Just collapsed. Everybody was in sound sleep. Just finished. Dead. Hundreds dead. Anything can happen. You may think, oh, United States, oh, no way. And I'm in this posh condo. It was a condominium. It was this posh condo and, you know, no way, it's nothing can go wrong. You know, I'm happily sleeping. All right, tomorrow I'll go and do this, that, this, that. There's no tomorrow. So, anything can happen at any time. There is nothing is a safety net. Anything can happen if the Lord wants. And the thing is, we are blind to it. We can't even see what is happening in front of us. Like, how are we, you know, going to go away from here? We don't even know. And it can come at any moment. We always say this, right? For years, like in our lectures, I remember I was saying this, like, oh, we can die at any moment, we can die at any moment, you know. It does not have to be that only old people will die. Anybody can die at any moment. Parikshit Maharaj died. Everybody will say, yeah, correct, yes. Good. Okay. I'll go to India, I'll have this, oh, not India, I'll go to Bali, or I'll go to some, you know, have some nice holiday and then come back. There's no urgency, like nothing in the head registered. Many people have heard this many times. Yeah, we'll die any moment. Yeah, correct. Okay. I'll have my holiday and come back. Okay, I'll see you. So this was the attitude. But now with coronavirus, we have seen practically that people of all ages are dying. It's starkly visible right now that death can come at any time to anyone. So just see, this is actually the case. And when it is not happening, when we are not dying, we are just being led into the trap. What does that mean? Our attraction for these possessive possessions are being increased. We are being lured into the trap. You know, like the hunter, if he wants to hunt the deer, he will play nice music and then they will come. And then he will just shoot them dead. So they are being lured into the trap of this nice music. Or the bait for the fish. Oh, food, yes. Go and then catch it and then you are food next moment. You are food for somebody. So, and just imagine, you see how it is working. So we are being lured into that bait. The Maya is giving us the bait. Okay, enjoy. Enjoy your family, this and that. I'll take you everything back. And then at that time, the pain, you will not be able to remember anything other than your family, and you will take birth again. Maya is a sadist. She will want to see that we remain here. Her real business is to train us in such a way that we will never disturb Krishna with any material desire. She wants to exhaust us of all material desires. So she will cause frustration in material life like anything. That is her business. So as a sadist, like it's exactly like a sadist, she will make sure that we have absolutely zero taste for material life. Until then, she will not allow us to go to Krishna. She will keep on, even if you're trying to go to Krishna, she will drag us down. She will drag us down. No, you're not going anywhere. Come. Why? What kind of a thing is that? Because in some religious forms, it is mentioned like, you know, God and Satan, as if they are like two opposing forces, and then God is against Satan and Satan is against God, and it's actually not like that. That's completely wrong idea. Yes, Satan means actually this Maya. So Maya wants to take you away from God. But that's actually not disservice to God, it is actually a service to God. Why? Because she wants to see, will you go to Krishna no matter what happens? I think you won't. Her way of thinking is like, I don't think you can go to Krishna. I don't think you are as strong. No, I'm strong. Maya cannot touch me. Oh, really? Okay, let's see. Then she will give one right slap. And then we are all over, we are just knocked out. You know how a boxing match, have you seen? Anybody getting knocked out? One punch on the chin and then they are out cold. In Britain, they call it knocking him spark out. Spark out means the spark of life is gone. Of course, he's not dead at the time. If not enough medical attention, he can die, actually. But he's just out cold. He's just concussion. Just completely gone. No external sensation. It's gone. So Maya will give us one time, and it doesn't take, if you watch any fighting match, it doesn't take even a split second for that punch to land. Usually the person who receives the punch does not even know where the punch came from. It was so fast, they did not even notice where it came from. So that's how Maya is. And in a split second, we are flat on the floor. And she's having a fun time dancing on our head. So, we cannot at any time be complacent and think we are good enough. We will never be good enough. The only way we can be good enough is completely take shelter of Krishna. Completely take the shelter of the spiritual master. Only then can we actually rise above this, you know, material contamination. So, this is the basic lesson from this, you know, verse. We haven't completed the purport, we'll go back to that. Oh, it's going here and there and here and there and here and there. What? Okay, here. In perfect determination, he should not hanker after unnecessary material things that entangle him by feelings of possessiveness. All these perfections and precautions are perfectly executed when one is directly in Krishna consciousness. Because direct Krishna consciousness means self-abnegation, wherein there is very little chance for material possessiveness. This is why the Goswamis have given up all attachment to worldly opulence, and they have taken up Krishna consciousness as their only activity. And Rupa Goswami gives the principle here. Srila Rupa Goswami characterizes Krishna consciousness in this way. Anasaktasya vishayan yatharham upayunjatah nirbandhah krishna sambandhe yuktam vairagyam uchyate prapanchikataya buddhya hari sambandhi vastunah mumukshubhih parityago vairagyam phalgu kathyate. When one is not attached to anything, but at the same time accepts everything in relation to Krishna, one is rightly situated above possessiveness. On the other hand, one who rejects everything without knowledge of his relationship to Krishna is not as complete in his renunciation. Now, this also applies to preaching. Now, if we give up the association of worldly-minded people, we have to give up in the matter of taking their association. We have to give up. But if we completely reject them and not even contact them, that is condemned again. Now, here in this verse, I'll show you a complete opposite verse. Like here it is, ekaki yata chitta atma. He said one should live alone in a secluded place and should always carefully control his mind. Now let me show you this other verse, Srimad Bhagavatam, canto 7, chapter 9, text 44. Now, this is an interesting verse.
Prayena deva munaya svavimukti kama maunam charanti vijane na pararthanishtha naitan vihaya kripanan vimumuksha eko nanyam tvadasya sharanam bhramatonu pashye.
Look at this. My dear Lord Narasimhadev, I see that there are many saintly persons indeed, but they are interested only in their own deliverance. Not caring for the big cities and towns, they go to the Himalayas or the forest to meditate with vows of silence, Maunavrata. They are not interested in delivering others. As for me, however, I do not wish to be liberated alone, leaving aside all these poor fools and rascals. I know that without Krishna consciousness, without taking shelter of your lotus feet, one cannot be happy. Therefore, I wish to bring them back to shelter at your lotus feet. This is the mood of a devotee. He actually condemns this ekaki yata chittatma, where Krishna is actually proposing that, and Prahlad Maharaj is denouncing, in fact condemning that. How come? How come he is against Krishna's word? He is not. Because ekakiya the chittatma is just one side of things. So Srila Rupa Goswami, of course, Krishna also explained the other side of things. You know, the preaching in the last part, Krishna says, you know, he who is a preacher is very dear to me. So that, how can one be a preacher if he's alone somewhere? You know, in a cave. He can't be a preacher. What preaching is doing? To the bats or what? And bring some coronavirus. No. Because in the caves there are a lot of bats. Now, ya idam paramam guhyam madbhakteshva bhidhasyate bhaktim mai param kritva mame vaishyatya samshayaha. For one who explains the supreme secret to the devotees, pure devotional service is guaranteed, and at the end he will come back to me.
Nashatasman manushyeshu kashchin me priyakrittamaha bhavitana chame tasmad anya priyataro bhuvi.
There is no servant in this world more dear to me than he, nor will there ever be one more dear. So Krishna is saying the most dear servant is he who is a preacher. But then in today's verse he is saying, no, ekakiyata chittatma, stay in seclusion. So for those who can't preach, yeah, they may stay in seclusion. But in Kali Yuga even that is not possible. We have to stay in association of devotees so that we can actually receive the association of devotees. Seclusion means, as I have emphasized many times over in this class, staying away from non-devotee association. So Prahlad Maharaj is saying, no, I want to be in the busiest towns and cities of this world. I want to deliver all of them. I don't want to be liberated alone. So this is basically this principle of Rupa Goswami. You see, one is not attached to anything, but at the same time accepts everything in relation to Krishna. So he's not attached to the worldly people, but he accepts everything in relation to Krishna. Oh, they are also servant of Krishna. I should not associate with them and take their association and, you know, become a non-devotee. But even though they're non-devotee, they're actually parts and parcels of Krishna. So there is a relationship with Krishna there, and therefore my work, I have some work there. Like I have to do something. Because anything that is in relation with Krishna, we have something to do with it. A devotee always has something to do with anything that is related with Krishna. And what is not related to Krishna? Everything is. And therefore a devotee actually does the most welfare activity in the entire world. So on the other hand, one who rejects everything without knowledge of his relationship to Krishna is not as complete in his renunciation. So if he, like anything, it can be a hand phone, it can be the social media, it can be anything. Everything is related with Krishna and we have to use it in his service. That is understanding. But even people. Now, if I renounce the people without knowing their relationship with Krishna and not caring for them, that is not complete renunciation. Whereas, although I give up their association, but if I give my association and you know, make them devotees, that is proper renunciation. And Srila Prabhupada is a perfect example of that. He went to America, not learnt a single thing from them, but he taught them everything that he came with from India, from our Vedic culture. Everything he exported, or Sundagopal Prabhu says, transplanted. He transplanted the entire Vedic culture on these foreign lands, and it was a grand success because he never accepted their association. He gave his association to them, even to the point of when he was asked to register the society, he suggested the name as International Society for Krishna Consciousness. They said, some people suggested, you know, Krishna is like way too, you know, you will be excluding all the others. Let's say God Consciousness, why not? He said, no. God means everybody will come now. Every demigod, everything, that's not a clear understanding. Krishna, it has to be specific. And look at the success of the movement. I mean, who can match? Because he just focused on pleasing Guru and Krishna. That's all that mattered for him. So that is real renunciation. He gave his association, never took any association from them. Now, a Krishna conscious person well knows that everything belongs to Krishna, and thus he is always free from feelings of personal possession. As such, he has no hankering for anything on his own personal account. He knows how to accept things in favor of Krishna consciousness and how to reject things unfavorable to Krishna consciousness. He is always aloof from material things because he is always transcendental, and he is always alone, having nothing to do with persons not in Krishna consciousness. So this is what it means by alone. Again, having nothing to do with persons not in Krishna consciousness in the matter of taking their association. But he has everything to do in giving his association. What need was there for Prabhupada to give up his comfortable residence in Vrindavan and go to America and live among those maniacs, hippie maniacs? What was the need for Prabhupada to do that? Was their association so valuable that he has to leave this entire holy place, holy land, and then go on the sea and suffer these heart attacks and go to that other side and live with some bunch of jokers? Not jokers, actually, they were quite tough to deal with. Why did Prabhupada have to go there? To give association. Give. That's why when one student in university in I think MIT, Massachusetts Institute of Technology, which is the top university in the world, apparently. So, he was giving a talk there. And one of the Indian students who was studying there, he stood up and said, Swamiji, what is the need of all these religion and God and all this? This is the age for technology. You know, we have to do that. I mean, what is the... These are all outdated. Come on. So Prabhupada said, well, you have come here to take their association. You learn from them. You are a beggar. You are begging from them for their paltry knowledge. I here am a giver. My position is much higher than yours. How did that answer the question? Because he thinks he is some big time and Prabhupada is nothing. But if Prabhupada is nothing and he is big time, why is he a beggar of knowledge, beggar of those technical skills? Whereas Prabhupada is a giver. If Prabhupada is nothing, then he is not a giver, right? He is not a beggar. Prabhupada is not a beggar who have gone to the West for some extra dollars. No. Bhiksham de extra dollars and then... No, that was not Prabhupada's mission. Oh, not enough money in India, I'll go to the West and collect. No. So Prabhupada said, I'm not a beggar. You are a beggar. I'm a giver. So this India is supposed to export this knowledge, this culture, everywhere. So that is the job we have to do, and for that we have to associate with those people who are way outside the Vedic culture. But we have to give our association and not take. So that is the sum and substance of this verse. So, I'll take any questions at this moment. Dhiradas is asking, the classification of three kinds of devotees is given to introspect on ourselves or to judge others? Both. Both. Because how am I going to associate with the senior devotee in a proper way? How am I going to associate with equal devotees, and how am I going to associate junior devotees? And of course, where do I stand? How do I know he is my senior, he is my equal, or he is my junior? That means I must know where I am, right, from the first place. So, it acts both ways to evaluate ourselves and also to evaluate others, because we have to choose our association wisely and appropriately. So that's why it is important for both evaluating oneself and others. Satyam Chaudhary. Hare Krishna Prabhu, just like after watching a movie, a person is contemplating on it full day, no, full month, at least full week. How can we also attain the same thing for Bhagavad Gita or Bhagavatam class? I mean, why we are not contemplating on the things that are discussed in Bhagavatam class? You're not contemplating? We must contemplate. That should be our state always, actually. Contemplating. So, you know, if it is, because, you know, with in a movie, we go with interest. If we have interest, then we will contemplate. We will be hooked to that. If our interest is not there, then we will not contemplate. Why does one think about one's family members? Why is it so attractive? Because there is a rasa, that is, you know, the love. There is interest there. That's why we can think of them. Why that example is given, where the woman, you know, the extramarital affair, where she thinks of the man other than the husband more intensely because of her affection for him. Because these are the things, affection is what drives that constant remembrance. Bhajatam Pritipurvakam. Pritipurvakam means imbued with affection. And that affection has to be gotten. And there is a nice verse in the Srimad Bhagavatam, first canto, second chapter, verse 16. Shushrushoha Shraddhanasya Vasudeva Katharuchisyan Mahatsevaya Vipraha Punyadirthan Nishevanat. O twice born sages, by serving those devotees who are completely freed from all vice, great service is done. By such service, one gains affinity for hearing the messages of Vasudeva. So if we engage in the association of devotees and in their service, associating with devotees may not mean, Vanchakalpa Prabhu, Vanchakalpa, Hare Krishna. This is not association. Association means serving the devotees. They may not ask any service, but we have to ask the devotees, what can I serve, what can I do? The devotees will not ask for anything personal. Sometimes, yeah, the spiritual master, you know, sometimes, you know, he may have to be taken care of, you know, his necessary. Sometimes Prabhupada got massage and all that. That's, you know, one aspect. But the majority of the aspect is the taking up of his instruction. And his instruction will always be how to serve Krishna. So the spiritual master is serving Krishna, and we have to assist him in his service. We have to assist. No, Prabhu, he has enough servants. No, why? He has enough assistants. I don't need to serve. No, let him. No, there is never enough servants, or there are never enough assistants, because unlimited service to do. If even one person in this world is not devotee, there is service to left to be done, preaching. How many people are not devotees? Practically whole world. Even devotees are just half baked, many. No standard, no quality. There's so much work to be done. So we can never say, oh yes, enough. We have to, even if the devotee doesn't say anything, we have to notice, okay, maybe this one will help him. Okay, let me do this and assist him in this. That, you know, that itself, that attitude is what fuels this affinity for hearing Krishna's message. And how can you not be inspired? It is very intriguing and very interesting, right, to know so much actually from our books. So it's actually very interesting. But I'll show you why it cannot be interesting at this point. And why? 7.
Syat Krishna nama charita disitapya vidya pittopatapta rasanasya narochikanu kintvadaradanu dinam khalu saiva jushta svadvikramad bhavatita gadamulahantri.
The holy name, character, pastimes and activities of Krishna are all transcendently sweet like sugar candy. Although the tongue of one afflicted by the jaundice of avidya, ignorance, cannot taste anything sweet, it is wonderful that simply by carefully chanting these sweet names every day, a natural relish awakens within his tongue, and his disease is gradually destroyed at the root. So what we have to do? Just keep on taking the medicine of Krishna's names and Krishna's topics. Just keep on doing it, and the relish will awaken in the heart. Because we are now with this jaundice of avidya. When we have jaundice, we cannot taste anything. Our taste buds are dead. So at that time, we can't taste anything. But if we just take the medicine, sugar candy, by the 4th, 5th day, you know, one starts to taste it as sweet. And that is the beginning of his recovery, when he can actually taste it. So we just have to keep on doing it, and the taste will come. We have to do it. Not mechanically, we have to do it with full attention, and then automatically you will contemplate on these points, and you know, you will think about these things. I mean, even when you see things in the world, you will connect it with the scriptural knowledge that you have, you know, learned. So in that way, one has to live and always see how scriptures are always relevant at every point in time. So it requires some training to see like that. That's why if we hear Prabhupada's lectures, if we read his books, we will get the intelligence. And slowly and by, we can become more and more Krishna conscious. And one day we can become completely Krishna conscious.
Dhiradas, are all impersonalist Mayavadis?
Not so. Some are Brahmavadis, but they are not exactly Mayavadis. They can be saved. Mayavadi Krishna Aparadhi. But Sukadeva Goswami, he was a Brahmavadi. He was in the impersonal understanding. But he was not especially offensive to Krishna, and therefore he could take it up. Same thing with the 4 Kumaras. But one who is envious, he cannot. If he is envious of the natural, the form of Krishna, then he cannot. Okay, so anything else?
Dhiradas, scientists say that our universe is expanding, and we know from Shastra that universes are formed because of the exhalation of Mahavishnu. So is there any connection?
Yeah, you can say.
And they'll be again shrinking back when it is destroyed. So that is also going to happen. Now, the only hole, black hole, they say, sucks everything into it. The only thing I can think of is the pores of Mahavishnu, into which they will go back at the end of destruction, end of the creation. So, that is the only hole I can think of. So, of course, their understanding is all very... You don't have to worry about exactly tallying with their kind of understanding. We will just explain as we understand it. And if any parallel is found, we can highlight that, but we don't really care. And we don't validate our statements of Shastra by some speculative statements of so-called scientists. We don't need that validation from them. But if there is some, you know, parallel that can be drawn, or if there is some connection, then we can always highlight and we can show that how Vedas are already saying this. But if it doesn't show, then we just have to condemn the whole thing. But we have to understand in this way that whatever Krishna has said is always true. And whether it matches or not with the scientist's way of explaining, it doesn't matter. If it matches, then you can say that, okay, see, Krishna has already said what you have said way before. Like Einstein's theory of relativity. Time does not move in the same dimension everywhere. It moves at different speeds. And that is already said in the Bhagavad Gita. 8.17. Sahasrayuga paryantam aham yad aharyad brahmano viduhu. So, his lifespan, his one day, Brahma's one day and our one day is totally different. So, the time is different. So, the relativity is already said. So, if there is some kind of that kind of coincidence or connection, you can just highlight that. You see, we already have. And if it doesn't match, just reject the whole scientists, whatever they're doing. Whatever it is, we don't place much emphasis on what the scientists say. We just place emphasis on what Krishna said and just present it like that. Because Krishna knows best. With our tiny brain, how much can we understand, you know? Ramya Ashok, say about Ekadasi Virata. Tamil way of saying Ekadasi Virata. Well, that is a whole different topic. I have already made a video about Ekadasi. Maybe somebody can share a link for that in the comment section. So, Ekadasi Vrata video, I have in great detail, I have done a very, very long video. You can watch that. Maybe somebody can put that link there. Alright, so thank you all very much. And we'll meet you again in whichever is our next meeting with you. Until then, thank you all very much again. Shrila Prabhupada ki jai, Bhagavad Gita ki jai, Ananta Kodi Vaishnava Vrinda ki jai, Nitai Gaur Premanande, Hari Hari Bol, Hare Krishna. I'm just waiting for that link of the Ekadasi video from our ISKM TV lecture series, and then I can close this live stream. There it is. So, importance of Ekadasi. That's the video. You can go and watch. Alright, Hare Krishna.